D. Barber, what's up? You can pause that, baby. Steve Lobel on the check-in. The Blues Brothers on the check-in. Lucky Church on the check-in. This is the Fat Joe Show, the realest show on IG. If you're looking for content, if you're looking for the realness, if you're looking for the topics that's going to change your life, you do it here. If you're looking for somebody to twerk and shake their ass, it's not here. DJ Khaled, the big show. Tonight we got an amazing special guest. Of course, you know, ain't nothing changed. Rest in peace, my brother Fred the Godson. Yesterday he passed away. My favorite lyrical monster, underground rapper at the time. My little brother, man, we've been mourning, we've been grieving, we've been going back and forth. You know, he repped the BX. That's my brother. I love him to death, man. Chubby Baby, what's up, Chubby Baby? Let me tell you something, man. Today, we done had some big guests. We done had some big guests in Corona Vision, Fat Joe. We done had AOC. We done had Van Jones. We done had DJ Khaled. We done had Mike Tyson. We done had anybody you name on this motherfucker, but ain't nobody like Diddy. Lord Finesse on the check-in. D-I-T-C. Shout out Diamond D, Chubby Baby. This is the biggest in the game. No one comes off like P. Diddy. And we're going to get into it like you know how we get into it. It's simple as that, man. I got a little wine. You know, I know I'm supposed to be rocking the Ciroc, but I got a little wine for the vibes, you know. James Cruz on the check-in. Original bad boy. Yeah, rest in peace, my brother, man. My brother, Fred the Godson, man. We just trying, man, to get past this fucked up time, this coronavirus time, man. This is the wackiest shit I ever seen in my life, man. This whole coronavirus, man. But I'm going to get into it with Diddy. Diddy, I'm waiting on you, baby. Just say you here. There we go. Say no more. It's on and popping. No one comes off like P. Diddy. Get that other song. The other one. Tell mommy. No one comes off like P. Diddy.
What's up, my brother?
Pop.
What's going on?
You started out in Harlem, modest beginnings.
Yeah.
Shout out to Miss Janice. I love her to death.
That's
a certified billionaire in these streets. You ain't like these other channels, so you went and bought your own channel. You started off as an intern. Wound up being the youngest, most successful A&R in the music business. Behind the likes of Mary J. Blige, Jodeci, Notorious B.I.G., Mace, The Lox. And so much more. What's up, nephew? Yeah, your sons are on the check-in too, boy. Yo, Diddy, how many Grammys? How many Grammys now?
Three Grammys. I was robbed of my fourth Grammy.
I'm sure.
And I always wanted to get it off my chest. No. I'll tell you about the fourth Grammy story. Because I got to get it off my chest. To something in my spirit. You know, because you know I don't do this, Joe. You know what I'm saying? I want to just give a disclaimer to everybody. I know y'all doing a lot of lives and the talks and all that. I'm doing a lot of strategizing, so I'm only doing this for my brother, Joe. But,
this
Joe, I need to get
show.
That off my chest. I got Fat Joe, Big Joe, Joey Crack. I got three Grammys, but there was one that y'all don't know how I got jerked up on it, and we'll get into that.
I thought you was gonna get into it right now. It's a rock, baby.
Nah. I was loving the setup. I was just letting you know.
I mean, you interrupted the setup, man. You got the planet Earth on here, man. All right. They can't wait. Let me tell you something. I've been here under quarantine having real talk with people. You know, AOC endorsed Joe Biden on this joint right here. You know, we got people talking some things they don't necessarily normally talk. So when I invite my brother Puff, We family over 25 years. I'm like, yo, pup, we going to get into it. Always friendly. We salute you. I'm trying to give you your roses. Every time I see you, every time I talk to you, I say, no one comes off like P. Diddy. That is a fact. I'm going to talk current events, and then we're going to move around. Georgia.
All right.
Do you think it's a coincidence that they opened up Georgia, Atlanta, home of black people, knowing damn well that the coronavirus is killing more black people than anything else?
Say it again. You broke. Say it the last part again. You broke up.
I'm gonna set it
you
off.
Says, with you Georgia. Said, "Is it a coincidence?"
Do you think it's a coincidence that they opened up Georgia when we know Atlanta is the mecca of black people?
I would just say this. You know what I'm saying? I'm not jumping all the way. I don't think it's a conspiracy theory. What's going on? It's evident what's going on. You know what I'm saying? It's evident that it was set up and planned like this. So to talk about conspiracy theory, no, they blatantly doing it right now. You know, what's being done is blatantly being done. Like if you're a sucker and you out in the streets, and you keep on getting punked. If you're in jail, you're going to get turned out. You know what I'm saying? And we done got turned out because we done let ourselves be pushed around too much. And having done nothing to fight back about it, we accept it. That's our normal, you know? And so, nah, there ain't no coincidences with nothing. You know what I'm saying? And it's going to stay that way until, you know, a time like this. Everybody's eyes, like, we got to, like, wake up. Their Instagram. You know what I'm saying? We got to really come out and learn how. Sorry, what's going on? You know what I'm saying? I think it's blatantly. We got a chance. We got a choice to fight back or we stay in modern slavery. So I want to get to the smoke. So that's all I've been out here doing currently is just getting to whatever smoke there is because tomorrow's not promised. And I'm not going to be living in this situation or watching us living in, when I say living in a situation, yeah, I may live in a nice house, but I feel the pain of my people. I know what the pissy hallway smells like, the roaches on the face. I know what it means to come up. And I know what it means to be fucked up, not to even be able to go to the doctor. They talking about going to the doctor. I'm just ready to get to the smoke right now because this is a lot of deaths. We losing a lot of soldiers, a lot of family members.
Before this, Puff, you started talking black excellence. You know, I know you from making hits, throwing the greatest parties in the world. Something woke you up recently in the last couple of years. And just last week when you invited me to the state of emergency, at what point, what you said, yo, my money's up, I can say whatever I want, because I know you do business with a lot of people, not just black people. We may represent the urban culture, but you do business with a lot of people, white people, Asians, whatever. What woke you up that you said, yo, enough's enough, I'm going to go represent my people?
Season, when I first came out to L.A., you know, I went through a little season of enjoy this thing, you know? You know, I partied for like maybe 7 years. And, you know, as things was going on, you know, I kind of felt like I lost my purpose because I wasn't really making music. And I was like, well, what is my new purpose? And it just, you know, Kim was in my ear talking to me just about, you know, how we're going to raise the family. And she was just like, yo, black man, you got a job to do, you know? And I remember I'm Not Your Negro came to me to watch it. When I watched it, James Baldwin and just seeing something and having her say that to me in a way that was real. Like she was like, when a black woman looks at you and like, But black man, you need to wake up. You need to get on what you here for. It really woke me up from then that I made a promise that I wasn't going to leave this earth unless my people were better. And also, black and brown, it's all the same.
That's a good point, Paul.
You have to love yourself enough to want to fight back. So, and show some, and that's all I've been trying to do and trying to get preachy with it. But it was just like it was Kim, and it was just having an awakening. You know, I was going through a metamorphosis, having an awakening, changing, growing, elevating, and that was a part of it. My purpose was to do anything I could to make sure.
I love that, man. I love the way you're moving. When you talk black and brown, you know, Big Pun's first single, Boricua.
Yo, hold on, I'm saying my wife. I'm a little blurry.
So find the Wi-Fi. Big house, guys. I've been there. That house is big, man. That house is big. Yo, Puff. So what I'm saying is,
this is the way we're supposed to live.
His first single, Boricua Morena. We always inclusion. You know, the birth of hip hop was created by Latinos and blacks, and it's always ironic to me, right? And we're gonna bounce all over, but it's always ironic to me. Like, say back in the day. The little tension with the East and the West. And now you raised your whole family in L.A. Like, I mean, was that ever a conversation with you and Big when he was alive? Like, he want to move to L.A.? Or is this premeditated? Or you just said, I'm going to L.A.?
Nah, I mean, it was...
Like, that's something. Know. Like, that's
yeah,
something.
Yeah.
You live in L.A. and your family and y'all...
It wasn't my choice. Kim had broke up with me and bounced and went to L.A.
Oh. So you went and followed the kids and Kim...
I followed the kids and everything. Then Justin got a thing to...
UCLA.
UCLA. And it was just that's where I had to be. You know what I'm saying? I lost my girl. I couldn't lose my family. I wasn't trying to be on that. So L.A. was the place. And you know,
it's so crazy because I come to your house when I'm in L.A. Soul Food Sundays. The whole L.A.'s in your house. I'm like, this is amazing. This amazing, like, transformation. Like,
yeah.
To where, you know, and yeah. Your kids, you know, they from New York, they forever, but. They from L.A. L.A. love them. Like, you know, I go out there, they doing the L.A. dance. They doing that. I'm like, yo, this shit, like,
But at the end of the day, we real ones. We ain't just staying on this side of town. You know what I'm saying? We definitely, you know, going and rocking with the people. And L.A. got a lot of love. And it's like, you know, I went through something traumatic here. But at the same time, I'm going to go anywhere I want. I'm at the end of the day, I'm going to live anywhere I want. I'm never going to live in fear. I'm going to just live in love. And, you know, that was a tragic something, you know, most tragic things that happened in my life. But at the same time, you know, if my kids is living out here, I'm going to be living out here.
You know, when Pun died under different circumstances, I went through depression for like 2 years straight. And like seeing a psychiatrist. And, you know, like, I look out the window, it'd be a sunny day, it'd be cloudy. My wife get up, if she sprayed perfume, I got mad. Like, you know, I went through the real depression. And it's hard to break up. Like, I don't think nobody's ever asked you or ever, you know, what type of shit you went through when Big died and you know, like, you know, it was all on TV, you know, with Pun when he passed away. I tried to run to Miami. The first thing the waiter did was serve me food and sorry about your brother. And so, and I couldn't escape it. No way. Like, what did you go through emotionally, like, around that time?
Oh, man. Hey, yo. Yo, Joe, I wasn't even prepared for this. You thought said we was going to get on the phone and just be talking some fun stuff. All right,
so we ain't got to talk. Yo,
nah, 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 nah. No, no, no. Yo, I'm with the smoke. I'm glad. I want to give you the story before I want to give anybody else.
Yeah, I want to inspire the people.
But you know, I just need you to, I need you to find a bottle of a Ciroc in that motherfucker, though. Yeah,
yeah,
real,
yeah,
though.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm in there. I'm with you. Pop. This is going to be inspiration, man.
Nah, it's all
young
good.
Young brothers and sisters out
hey,
there.
Yo.
They want to know, man. All they know. All my daughter knows is my Uncle Puff is rich. They don't know.
No, you asked great questions. Joe, after this, we're going to talk about a show on Revolt because you're definitely asking great questions. Me and you talked about that. Let's put it
we
in the air.
Biggest
Let's
in
tell
the
truth.
Game, Puff.
You know what I'm saying? You Puerto Rican Oprah. For real, nigga. You Puerto Rican Oprah.
Talk about it.
It was crazy, you know, to be at the top of the game in hip hop and to go out to a party when we about to just drop the album. We didn't even drop Life or Death. This is the first time we hearing Hypnotize in the club. He never got to hear it in the club. That's the first and only night he got to hear Hypnotize in the club. They played the thing 30 times. You know what I'm saying? I was always bouncing around and everything, trying to, like, you know, chase the ladies and have fun, and just was the real, like, you know, I was more personable. He liked to sit in the cut, you know what I'm saying? Just smoke his weed. And I was like, yo, tonight is special. We done did something special. You know what I'm saying? He was supposed to go to London the next day. And then he was like, yo, I never get to chill with you, man. We done did something great. Can I just postpone one to London for one more day? And I was like, nah, you need to go to London. He just missed the plane. You know what I'm saying? And I would just like, and he showed up at the crib I was at, said, what's up? Yo, let's go to the Soul Train joint. And so we there, and he was just like, yo, but tonight though, I want to chill. And so that's why you got all them pictures of us in the cut with the Cristal and all that. We was just chilling. We was just chilling. He's definitely, like, off our game as far as, you know, the intensity of the situation. You know, we just, like, you know, we got loose, just like a lot of cats, you know, get caught slipping. We just felt loose. We felt too comfortable, you know. And so we went out. We had a great night. Heard Hypnotize. They played, like, 20 times in the club. You know, I was aggressive Puff at that point. So I'm going and grabbing the mic, announcing that shit. Turning it over. Yeah, we up in this motherfucker. Yeah, love to LA, love to that, love to the Crips, the Blood. You know what I'm saying? I'm comfy. You know what I'm saying? Too comfy. And you know, but he got to hear the records. And then when we got out of when we left out of there, you know what I'm saying? Life was changed forever. And I was in a state of like shock. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was in a, because this wasn't like a tough guy bumping in nobody. Big ain't mess with nobody. He ain't go and say nothing disrespectful about Pac or Suge or nothing like that. You know what I'm saying? He was just holding his head, you know what I'm saying? Taking the high road to stay focused on the money. And I was like, yo, what the fuck? What the fuck is this? Like, this is just... And then I was just frozen. I was just in shock until the day I made Missing You. That's the first day I went out the house. You know what I'm saying? First they went and they went and hit me upstate somewhere. You know what I'm saying? Because they were just concerned about me. Nah, like my family. You know what I'm saying? For like 2 weeks, and then I just went home, and you know, one day I heard the Sting joint, and then I went to the studio with Missing You, and I just started to get up and fight back. And make sure the world would know he's a legend forever. And now when this thing is over, we get inducted in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And that's what the fuck is up.
know Biggie my king, man. You know Biggie my king, boy. Biggie my king. And let me tell you something, Puff. I was there when Biggie made Hypnotize. I was in Daddy House with him. And I'm going to tell you, I tell this story all the time because it's one of my claim to fame, me just being there. And from 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock, he had 10 Spanish girls come. From 2 to 3, he had 10 Asian girls come. From 3 to 4, he had 10 Italian girls come. From 5 to 6, he had 10 black chicks come. I'm like, Jesus Christ, this... Yo, Biggie had that shit popping, boy. Like, yo, crazy, B. And
yeah, no doubt.
But we always,
no doubt.
What was crazy was, and I think it's wrong of us now that I'm older and I think about it now, with you being vulnerable and telling us that story, was like, even though you was going through so much, we looked to you for strength, the hip hop community. And it's like, you had to do it yourself. And no matter what, we always thought like Puff had the answer. That's how I always looked at it. So then we always love Big Papa. Or what you doing missing you, we just always felt like, yo, Puff has the answer. You know what I'm saying? And and that was crazy for me. You always turn tragedy into triumph. And that's a big That's big to me, because a lot of people pretend to be warriors. A lot of people pretend to be ready for war, but a lot. A lot of people, when they get their backs to the wall, they don't really come out swinging like that.
Yeah, this ain't shit. I don't even want no man. Let's just keep it positive.
Yes, everything is positive, man.
Yeah.
I want to know, because I was there from the beginning, and I tell people this story, and I'm gonna tell you, and you know I tell you this all the time. I knew Puff Daddy when he had a see-through chain on. The gold chain was so slim that it was like you could see it. It was invisible. And I remember one time I was in the Lyricist Lounge or somewhere. And Biggie was up there just battling everybody. And you was like, yo, who want to fuck with my man? Who next? And he battling white boys, like everybody. He killed like about 20 guys. And it was always the same Puff Daddy. You was up there, super energy. Yo, fuck that. Yo, tear these niggas up. Yo, this. And I was just like, I don't know. How did you turn that guy who is the underground battle rapper into the biggest sex symbol, Frank Sinatra of the world? Like, that juicy, that's the formula. Like, with me and Big Pun, I can't lie to you, we jacked the formula. The formula was like, it was like when you took that music and you threw the juicy music on them, and we was like, oh my God, we never heard no shit like this. Whose idea? This was definitely your idea, huh, Puff?
Yeah, I mean, everything was a partnership. As far as the music, that was my lane. You know what I'm saying? As far as the music, identifying the music or saying, yeah, this is one we got to go with. That was my part. But as far as lyrically, I ain't had nothing to do with lyrically,
because
he would just sit there and not say nothing. That's like a play. You just like, I back up. You know what I'm saying? Because I know how to produce the great ones. And Juicy, when we put it on, I was just seeing him as, cause I was fresh at the time, you know what I'm saying? I had access to a little bit more capital and Big at that time, so I was swayed. And so he was like, yo, I want to be fresh like you. I don't want to hear, so we done hooked up with 5001, you know what I'm saying? 5001, and then we hooked up with the brother. Shout out to my brother, 5001.
5001,
yeah.
Shout out my brother,
and
guy,
then they just started lacing them, and we just started making everything, you know, handmade. And I'm saying that was a part of the Juicy thing, was to show like a fly, Big, because Heavy D gave us the formula, really.
Heavy D was the first.
Yeah,
Heavy D fathered the whole
shit. This is when brands started becoming hot, like the Versace. So we came right on time, and we chose Versace. Niggas ain't know about Versace. We chose Versace, and then it went to the glasses. We chose Coogi. Niggas ain't know about Coogi. You know what I'm saying? We chose the whole look, and he was like, yo, he wanted to be fly like a small man. You know what I'm saying? He didn't want the big and tall and not have his size. And so as soon as he got to it, you know what I'm saying, he definitely just became a sex symbol because his just confidence and the way he walked in the room, you know what I'm saying, that was like,
I remember I went from being at Biggie's house in Brooklyn. I used to go visit Biggie in his house to, you know, me and him, army jackets, hoodies on, hockey jersey. He used to rock them hockey jerseys. And that night he was like, yo, make sure you come to the party. And I come to the party and the nigga got the salmon suit on with the hat, with the front, with the Gator shoes. Yeah. Hey, yo, fuck. I'm like, what the fuck? I just left them in Brooklyn on some regular thugged out shit. I go to the party, y'all on stage, and that's the famous party.
It was Palladium. The Palladium when
it's a famous picture.
It was one of the joints at the Palladium.
The Ed Love is in the picture.
Yeah, that's the platinum.
Everybody's
party.
In the picture. I was at his house earlier, and the next thing I knew, he had the shit on. And I tell people a story, right? You know how you say, you know, people don't change. Sometimes the perception of people change, and we be guilty of that. So Biggie went on a run. That was when he was number one, two, and three. And